the age profile of beekeepers in the last few years has been declining, and a lot are maybe in full-time employment, have a lot of demands on their time, young children, and in general, you know, even if you don't fit into that bracket, our lives in general just seem to be an awful lot busier at the moment. We're either online, connected all the time, on our mobiles or some other electronic device. And all this basically means is that we have less time for our hobbies and less time for beekeeping and doing what we love to do. And this really means that we need to just be a little bit more organized and be more efficient and planning ahead and getting ahead of our beekeeping operation so that we can continue on to enjoy it in this really crazy busy world that we live in today. So I'm in full-time employment, working Monday to Friday, global role, so I travel a lot on calls or on conference calls early in the evening, early in the morning, late in the evening. So very little time for beekeeping Monday to Friday. And my beekeeping is really around, I'm a weekend beekeeper. I have about 20 colonies, produce nukes, produce overwinter queens, and I love to take part in honey shows. Obviously, that's the reason why I'm here. So, you know, with being busy Monday to Friday, it can be quite challenging to continue with 20 hives and show honey. And the idea of this talk is just really to give you some tips and some food for thought about how can you be that little bit more efficient so that you can continue on to enjoy the hobby. So with anything in life, the success is planning ahead, and it's no different, you know, for beekeeping. The secret really is to plan ahead, have a plan, and stick to that plan then as you go through the season. Now, no plan is going to be set in stone because, as we know, there's no two seasons the same. There's no two colonies the same. So you may have to change that plan as you go along and make decisions on the go. But if you don't have a plan in the first place, it's going to be very, very difficult to manage your time and be efficient with your time. So planning ahead is really, really the secret of, you know, being efficient with your beekeeping operation. And the first thing to really consider is, what do you want out of your beekeeping? Now, that's a personal question for all of us. You know, it's only you can answer that question. So what do you want from your beekeeping? How many hives do you want? And there may be a difference between how many hives you want and how many you can actually manage with your given available time. So that's something to think about. You know, I'd love to have 100 hives, but it's just not practical to have 100 hives. So you have to think about, what do you personally want out of your beekeeping? And as I say, I work in business, and we talk about having smart goals. You know, we talk about having smart goals so that we can achieve them and achieve them within our organization. And you can actually apply this thinking to our beekeeping operation. So smart being specific, so have a very specific goal with your beekeeping. I want to have 10 honey-producing colonies that are producing a minimum of 500 pounds of honey every year, maybe another 10 nucleus for sale, and produce our, you know, overwinter queens as well, maybe 5-10 queens every year. So very, very specific goal. And it's absolutely measurable. I know when I have achieved it, I know when I haven't achieved it. And it is realistic and achievable because I have achieved it over the past few years. So, you know, having that goal and in your mind knowing what you want from your beekeeping will really help you. And thinking about it now for next year. So how many colonies do you want next year? You know, and what's your plan from your beekeeping operation next year? So putting that plan together and then having your goals around what you want to actually achieve. This is another methodology we use in business as well. It's called the 5S. It actually comes from 5 Japanese words beginning with S, which I won't even attempt to pronounce. And we've translated them, you know, in the Western world, we've translated those into sort, set it in order, shine, standardize, and sustain, right? So 5S. And the methodology is used to actually organize work, your workspace or your work environment for efficiency and for effectiveness. And a lot of businesses use it, manufacturing facilities use it. And again, we can apply this kind of thinking to our beekeeping. And all it really means, if you take the autumn time, you come in, you harvest your honey, it's all about sorting out your equipment at that stage, right? So as you have your honey extracted and your frames, sorting out frames frames that need to be, you know, where the wax needs to be cut out, have those in one bundle, where frames that you can actually store and are good for next year within your supers. Your super boxes themselves, are there any that need repairing, or are some of them okay to be stored away, right? So it's really about sorting out your equipment and then setting it in order. So if you do have a bundle of frames that need wax cutting out, then cut out the wax, sterilise your frames, sterilise your boxes, and then store it only if it's clean. Right, so it's, and this will make you much more efficient come next springtime. You're not going, you know, to the garage or to the shed and looking at equipment that needs wax that needs to be cut out, frames that need to be cleaned, when your bees actually need you out in the apiary. So it's allow, if you do that now and you're ready now and over the winter time, it's allowing you to concentrate on your bees when they need you to be concentrating on them early next spring. So again, it's planning ahead and just being that little bit more efficient with our beekeeping. Here you can see a picture of what I'm talking about when I say cutting out old wax versus the new wax. The bottom picture there is obviously old, darker, blacker wax. That's the type of wax that we would cut out, sterilise that frame and have it ready for re-waxing then early next spring. And the top one is one we would leave, you know, leave, it's okay to use again. It's nice, fresh comb, it's drawn, foundation. And it's perfectly okay to use it. I'm sure if you talk to the honey judges here, you know, over the next few days, they actually will say that the honey that will come from the top frame there will be much nicer and fresher than the honey that you'll get, obviously, in the older, you know, blacker comb. And they can nearly taste the difference. And the judges will know who's swapping out foundation every year for fresh, you know, fresh foundation and keeping their foundation fresh. I spoke about, you can then obviously melt down your wax. So we have a Burker boiler, melt down the wax. And again, if we talk about efficiencies, there's a lot of efficiencies in beekeeping and we should be trying to eliminate any waste. So you can obviously melt down your wax and then you can have that ready for trade-in next year. So, you know, it becomes quite cheap or reasonable to be swapping out your older, blacker comb every year for fresh foundation. So melt down the wax and then you've waste elimination basically with, you know, your recycling and you're going to get your frames of foundation a lot cheaper than next year. Okay, so then continuing on that kind of 5S methodology or thinking with all of your equipment. So, you know, sort out your brood boxes. Taking in any brood boxes that are out of use should not be sitting in the apiary until next year. You should take them in. Look after them, sterilise them, clean them. Same with your roofs, sort your roofs, your floorboards. If any repairs need to be done, sorting those. And obviously your nukes. Apidea is another one. Not leaving apideas out in your apiaries all winter. By next year, they're going to be absolutely destroyed. So bringing them in, cleaning them, and again, only storing all of your equipment, you know, if it's clean. So you can see here the frames, this is where we would have cut out the wax out of the frames and they're ready for sterilising. You can see we use this stainless steel container where we're going to boil them up and sterilise them. So we'll either use we'll use caustic soda or the soda crystals. We have a gas ring there, so heat up the water and boil the frames. All of the scum will actually come to the top of the container. You'll see it rising off the frames. And they actually come out really, really clean, almost like new. And they're perfectly easy then to re-wax them next year. So getting all those type of jobs done. And you can see them here, rinse them down, and then we just leave them out to dry. And we can store them away and then come, you know, maybe March of next year, we'll start putting the wax back into the frames and have them ready to go when we need them, you know, from April onwards, really. Sterilizing. So if you do have a brood box of comb that's, again, okay to use next year, you know, it's maybe this year's comb or last year's comb and it's okay to use. You can actually sterilise that and sterilise your box. We use the 80% acetic acid. So it's 100 ml of the 80% acetic acid. We put a big plastic, you can see there, on the ground. Put your brood box on top of the plastic. put your 100 mil onto the rag, put that over the tops of the frames, and then put an eek crown board. Make sure that it's airtight. So we would bring, you can see there, cling film or the plastic up around the box to make sure that it's as airtight as possible. And you leave it there for 1 week. So it's 100 mil per brew box for 1 week. The ambient temperature should be somewhere around 15 degrees C for it to work best. And you can actually stack them, you know, one on top of the other, but you have to put 100 mil per brood box. So again, you know, getting all of these type jobs done, they'll be sterilized for next year. You can air them out and they're ready to put back into use again. And just making sure that there is no old black or wax in that box. You know, there's no point in storing something that has to be cut out next year, because you'll actually run the risk of just using it again next year. So if it's not there, you know, in April when you need it, you're going to have put in your fresh foundation. If it is there in the box and you're under pressure because you've limited time, you're just going to take whatever you have there and you're going to run off and you're going to use it, right? So making sure that you prepare it now, you know, your bees will thank you as well. They'll be a lot healthier if you do that. Scorching your, you can also use the blowtorch to scorch your equipment, your crown boards, your insides, your brew boxes, etc. But again, getting all of that done now and throughout the winter and early in spring, so that you don't have to concentrate on it then when you should be concentrating on your bees. Small things like the curlers even, having a box for them, you know, that they're not all spread around the place when you need them, like everything in its place really, but having a box, knowing what quantity of them are in the box, knowing that they're clean, so that when you do need them, you know exactly where to put your hand to get them, and they're clean, they're usable, and you're ready to go with them. So getting ahead. Your smoker gets quite, you know, over the season will get quite dirty, and again, preparing that for next year, right? The bellows, is the bellows working properly? You know, scrub it down, have it clean, store it away, ready to go. Okay, and then over the winter time, you continue with this over the winter time, obviously. It's, you know, you're going to continue trying to store your equipment and keep it clean. The other thing over winter, so people would ask me, how come you can prepare exhibits and be ready for honey shows and, you know, you're working Monday to Friday, you're beekeeping over the weekends. So you can actually prepare, like you can make candles over the winter time. And it's a lovely hobby, candles or wax models. You see some beautiful exhibits here at the show. And you can start preparing them over winter time. You know, in my mind, it's much better to start doing that than to be sitting in front of Coronation Street for an hour or half an hour, right? So you get a lot more enjoyment out of it. But you can prepare over winter. And because the shows come upon us quite quickly at the end of our season, when we're busy, you know, harvesting our honey and setting our bees right for the winter time, and there's a show on, and it's much easier to kind of say, I haven't time for the show because I'm too busy. But it wouldn't it be lovely to have a few candles that you've made over winter and said, you know what, I am going to go to the show, and it's really nice to partake in the show and be part of it. You'll gain so much knowledge and experience, you know, about exhibiting your products, but more importantly, how to prepare your products for sale. You get a lot of, you know, a lot of feedback about your products. So, you know, you can do some of this over the winter. It doesn't have to all pile up to the end of the season when the shows come upon us. Education, as we know, has a positive impact on our efficiency and effectiveness. And the winter time is a great time, you know, to do that. Continue on with your study groups, your lectures, go to all your lectures. And then when you're out in the apiary next year, you have a wealth of knowledge to draw on when you're presented with a particular situation. You know, so continue on. It definitely education and efficiency and effectiveness. You know, we need to continue on with our education through the winter time and prepare ourselves for next season. And this is one of my favourite ones, really, are the records. You know, we take our records as we go through the season, we write everything down, we may do select our queens for breeding from our records, etc. And then where do they go, you know? But over the winter time is a great time to actually take out those records and study them. So study, what did you do? So, you know, you'll know which hives actually were really, really good and produced, you know, a decent crop of honey. And it could be another hive sitting beside it that just didn't work out for you, right? But if you study your records, there may be something that you did differently, or something that you did, even comparing one apiary to the other, to another apiary, one apiary that's producing a good crop of honey and the other one is not performing so well. Study those records, because they may tell you what you need to do for next year, and you can work that back into your plan. And there, we can learn from our mistakes, right? So we can learn from what mistake did I make that this hive or this colony just did not, didn't produce the goal that I set out for myself at the start of the year. And work that back into your plans and your goals and start your new record card for next year. So even putting that together for next year, you can have it ready. And then just really having a continuous improvement mindset. Nothing is so good that it cannot be made better. So just continue to have that mindset that you can improve year on year on year with your beekeeping practice if we learn from our mistakes and learn how to be open to doing it somewhat differently the following year. As I said, making the candles, so you can see here, dipping the candles. A lovely, lovely hobby, really, and can be done at any time of the year once you have the wax. So now that you have your plan, you've your equipment all clean, then having your stock list of what equipment have you, match that against your plan for next year, and what do I need next year? Am I increasing? You need a certain amount of foundation for next year. Do you need nuke boxes, floorboards, roofs, etc., right? So putting together, over the next couple of months, what equipment do you actually need? Because, the January sales come around. I know the Thorns have a sale every year. We go to the Ulster Beekeeping Conference every year, and Thorns are there as well, and we've Donegal Bees and other suppliers. And you generally will get good deals, or they'll have sales at that time of the year. Now, if you don't know or don't have a plan for your bees for that season, then you probably don't know what you need. You'll either end up buying stuff you don't need, and you won't get the proper proper equipment or whatever you do need to actually fulfill your plan. So being ready for those sales, and I know beekeepers, they say, are very frugal, but sometimes I wonder, are we, right? It's really about being prepared for your January sales, know what stock I need. I'm going to, produce 5 nukes this year, so I need all the equipment to do that, etc. So really getting that ready. So then when you come into early spring and before the season actually starts at all, you can start making up your frames. You're not waiting until your first inspection to go out to the hives, to look at your hives and then say, oh, I'm going to need 20 frames to make up. I have to come back. I have to spend time making those up. Again, as I say, at the time of year when we should be out with our bees. So making your frames up early. Don't wax them too early, but you can wax them again before April. You could start waxing them, in March time frame. Start waxing the frames and having those ready. And even bringing the necessary equipment or spare equipment out to the apiary. And I'll show you a picture there of, if you want to bring your supers out to the apiary early before you ever start your first inspection, just make sure they're bee tight. You're going to need supers on your hive, so why not have them in the apiary for when you actually need them, as opposed to driving out saying, oh, I need supers. You have to drive home, get your supers, come back again. So you're just, you're just being that more efficient with your time. Making up the syrup before you're going to need the syrup. So you can prepare the syrup and make it up. You can put a small bit of thymol in it, will prevent it from fermenting in the containers, and make up your rapidillas, and have those ready. Go out and tidy your apiaries, so you can do all this work before the season actually starts. And you can see here, frames made up, frames waxed. We generally would date our frames as well, because No frame will stay in the hive longer than 3 years. And when I open and take off the crown board, I know exactly how many frames need to come out of each hive. And then you have your fresh frames of foundation with you that you can replace them with or put back in. So having everything ready there, you know, before the first inspection. This is where I was talking about bringing your supers out. You know, so if you have, you can bring the supers out. You can see there, they're bee tight. They're covered in cling film, roof on top of them. So the first inspection, I might not need them. Might need them maybe on the second or third inspection. Just cut off the cellophane, and then I can put one. I normally would put two supers on a hive on the first lot, because again, you know, you have to work, you have to make your management practices suit your available time. So if I'm not going to be able to get back out there, I would rather have them have two supers on than have one and they're looking for another one. So I put two supers on at a time on each hive, but I just cut that off maybe the second, third inspection or when they actually need it, and then I can, you know, disperse the supers onto the hives that that need supers at that time of the year. And it's there ready, waiting for me. I'm not spending time on driving back and forth and trying to cart it all out there. As I said earlier, you can make up your apodeas and have them ready, you know, so they're ready for when you want, if you're doing your queen rearing or you're using queen cells from your best hives. But you can see we use the hot wax to melt the starter strip onto the little frames in the apodeas. So they'll be all ready in the apodeas there. And then closer to the time, you can put your fondant in a little container and put that into the feed compartment of the apodea. But the important thing is to have them ready. And then as the season comes along, when I'm going out every weekend to the apiaries, I would always have a couple of apodeas in the car and a nuke or two in the car. So that the equipment you need when you're there, you have it with you, you know, and you're not having, again, to go drive back and look for it, etc. So bringing this with you as you go out, you might need it for, you know, the first few times and then you need it, but you have it there to actually to use. I spoke earlier about your having your hive inspections ready, but again, it's really, really important on your first inspection to start your record on your very first inspection. You know, start as you mean to continue. Because if you don't start in the first one, you'll have 2-3 inspections done before you'll actually start writing anything down. And you've lost valuable information, you know, about how they overwintered, what were they like, you know, on the first inspection. So very important to start your records on the very first time that you're there. And when you talk about records, there's all sorts of beekeeping applications or apps now out there that are available, and they improve the efficiency of keeping records. Now, there's nothing wrong with the traditional way of writing it down. You can actually be very, very efficient. We have a laminated card, actually, that we can just rub it out when we're finished and rewrite it again. But I generally would use numbers and letters. You can use shorthand. You can use whatever works for you. But writing records, you're not writing a novel. It's not going to take that much time. You can be pretty quick and fast with it. But there are applications out there, and this one is quite interesting, Beeking. And they've come up with an app, but it actually is voice recognizable. So you don't have to write anything or type anything, because a lot of people say, well, with the phone and the gloves, it's quite difficult to use the applications. But this one, you actually speak. And you can talk your records into it. It's a group in chap in Latvia, and he actually has 200 users of this app this year, and they're using it in their training apiaries as well. And the company themselves are going around to beekeepers to teach them how to use the application to be more efficient with their apiary records and their note-taking, and be more efficient with their beekeeping in general. Now, I just picked that one because the last time I gave this talk in Ulster, I think it was, this chap was actually there, and he came up and spoke to me afterwards. So I was in contact with him recently, and he said it's going really, really well, and they have 200 users. and it's in Latvian and in English. But there's an amount of applications out there actually at the moment. Now, some of them will look for subscriptions, some of them will be free, some of them are useless, you know, so you have to just tread there with caution. But there are ways of, you know, getting more efficient, basically. But the important thing is keeping your records and having a record of your records and being able to review them over the winter. That is the important piece of this. We would, I haven't gone the application route as of yet, but what I would do with the cards is have them arranged by the next inspection date so that, you know, when I come, you know, out of work on Friday, my inspection cards are ready. I know exactly which hives and which apiaries need to be inspected. You know, I'm not looking through all the cards. And basically that means you're not disturbing hives unnecessarily. You're not disturbing your bees unnecessarily. You don't have to open every colony in every apiary every time you're going out to do an inspection. You know, so I arrange them by the next inspection date. And as I say, you can use the shorthand or whatever really, whatever suits you. I picked this out of Ted Hooper's book, Bees and Honey, and it's one of my favourite books and favourite beekeeper, Ted Hooper. And I just thought this was particularly interesting because he actually speaks about making your beekeeping more efficient as well. And this was efficient inspections to track your spring build-up. So when he goes to the hive, and let's say on the first inspection, you see four frames of brood inside in the colony. You record it obviously in your records, so you record four frames of brood on the first inspection. And what he speaks about doing is moving those four frames to the outside of the box. So he moves them to, you know, one side of the box, right, and then will close up his hive. And on the next inspection, when he's coming out there, he only starts at frame five. So he's not having to lift out the first four because he already knows there's brood in him, and all he wants to know is the development and the build-up of the colony since the last time he looked at it. So he's looking at frame five, frame six, etc., and then the next time maybe he's only looking at, you know, seven and eight or whatever it is, right? So I thought it was just interesting when we talk about efficiencies. This is one that I have used myself in the apiary. Now, this is it's suitable if you need to have a suitable layout where your colonies are in close, you know, close proximity to each other. But it's just one that I use. So let's say box one there. I take off my roof, take off the crown board, the supers, queen excluder, etc. Do the normal hive inspection that I want inside in that brew box. But when I'm putting it back and assembling it back together again, I assemble it back up to the crown board only, and then I will take the roof from the adjacent hive and just move that across onto it and leave the, you know, the first roof on the ground. And then continue that on. So with hive two, same thing, look at it, put the supers back down on the roof, that the first roof that's on the ground, put it back up, and then I'll move the third roof back over onto the second hive, right? And all of that, you get the idea, right? But all of that just really means that I'm not having to lift down and lift up a heavy roof every time on every single hive. And that just reduces lifts, number one, but it also reduces fatigue when you're in the apiary, right? So the roofs are obviously can be quite heavy. And you've just reduced the number of lifts that you're going to actually have to bend down and lift up a roof and lift it back up again on your hive. And your back will thank you, and you'll be a lot fresher when you come walk away from the apiary as well. So just, you know, the idea really is just to think about how you can be that little bit more efficient, and also to, you know, to prevent fatigue and that when you're out and in the apiary. And speaking about fatigue, so ergonomics. Ergonomics and efficiency really go hand in hand, right? And, you know, reducing kind of fatigue, you are going to be more efficient. You're going to enjoy your beekeeping more as well, which is, you know, that's why we love our beekeeping, and you want to enjoy it. It's a hobby for most of us after all. So we really should be enjoying our beekeeping. But having the appropriate size boxes, I started out with commercial hives purely because, you know, I come from a beekeeping family. Dad, my brother, they all had commercial hives. And we've a lot of big burly beekeepers in South Tipperary who are, you know, well able to lift commercial hives. But over time, I've now transitioned completely to the national hive. And it's not about the brood box, it's more about the frames themselves. So, you know, the short lugs and a wider frame was quite strenuous on my shoulders and my back. So their shoulder strain is real. Whereas the smaller frame, when you're going through an amount of them in each of your apiaries, it's much easier, you know, and much lighter to hold. But everybody has to make that decision for themselves. But it's just to think about it, because I did inherit them and, you know, I just thought this is beekeeping until you kind of experience something else and there is an easier way and it suited me better. Having the appropriate height hive stands is another one. You know, if you're going to be stooping over brood boxes all day, bring a stool if you need a stool, you know, and if it makes life easier, there's nothing wrong with bringing a stool. But making sure that the hive stands, so again, I'm vertically challenged, and I was working with tall beekeepers and the hive stands were quite high, so again, I was straining. You know, so having the proper height for your beekeeping and for yourself, very, very important. Having a cart with wheels for moving supers in and out of honey houses, something simple, right? You can see here, this is a lift that I invested in a couple of years ago, a mechanical lift. And you can use this in the apiary, or as you can see there, you use it to move supers in and out of the honey house. But in the apiary, when the supers get very heavy, it's quite difficult for me to lift supers off unless I have help. But with the mechanical lift, you can see there, it just clamps in on two supers. I can actually lift them and move them to one side, do my regular inspection, and I can lift them and put them back down on the brood box again. And it all means that you're, you know, when you come home, you're full of the joys. You're not coming home wrecked and tired after your beekeeping, and everybody's saying, why would anybody beekeep? Because she always comes home and she's, you know, so... it's much more enjoyable, right? You're not as tired. If you're not as tired, you're more efficient and you're more capable of getting the job done really well. And the other thing, like if you don't have a lift or someone to help you lift the brew box, bring along a spare empty super. And on your top super, then you can take out some of the frames, put them into the empty super, and then lift your super off, right? So thinking about your back and thinking about all easier ways to make it that little bit easier on you. Beekeeping is quite a time-consuming physical hobby. You know, so we need to mind our backs. And if we do, then we can continue beekeeping, you know, into tender years. It's a great hobby. You can downsize it at any stage. You know, so... And it's just thinking of ways how we make that little bit easier that we can continue on to enjoy it. And I have there work smarter. So it's all about working smarter, not harder. You know, so think about smarter ways of working. Your mother always told you lift with your legs and not your back, right? So, you know, I would heed that piece of advice. Appropriate size hive tool is another one. I know, you know, we've a lot of suppliers here these few days, right? But having the right, that hive tool suits me, it suits my hand. A lot of other beekeepers would say it's too small, I can't work with it. You know, so making sure that you have something that suits your own, yourself. And again, work and time, breaks, hydrate, refuel. As I say there, it's a hobby, it's meant to be enjoyed. You know, and it's a lovely, you know, it's lovely just even bring along a flask and sandwiches and just to sit and watch your bees for a while. You know, we're always rushing around, as I say, we're going in on a mission to get into the hives, you know, and take the roofs off and get in there. Whereas, you know, if we can be more relaxed and even watch your bees, you can learn an awful lot from observing your bees. And I have a talk later on about observations from outside the hive, but you can learn an awful lot from just looking at your bees. And it's really, really enjoyable to do. And in the busy world that we live in, you know, you really appreciate that time And it's making sure that we're, you know, we're not overstretching and making it a difficult hobby for us. Again, this is one I use. So you can see there the smaller box. It's my inspection box that I would take with me when I'm going out to do my hive inspections. What I use it for really is to hold the first one or two frames. So as I take the first frame out of the hive, rather than leaving the first frame down by the side of the hive, you know, where if the queen can fall off on the ground, you know, if she's on now, obviously I'm looking for the queen, but if I don't see her and she's in there, she's safe, right? So she's safe in the box and she's not going anywhere. And it's just very convenient. You can see the smoker there sits on it nicely as well. It'll hold the smoker. So I can put the first one or two frames into this inspection box. Now, if you see the queen, I would always say, when you're going through your hive inspections, if you do see the queen, cage her and put her aside, because then you can actually go through the hive a lot quicker and you're not worried about the queen. So once I see the queen, I'd either cage her or else I put the frame and herself into that box, and I know exactly where she is as I go through the rest of the hive. And if you come across queen cells, you're not having to come back through the hive again to find your queen to do an artificial swarm or to take her out. So every time I see the queen, I put her aside so that I know where she is for the rest of that inspection and I know that she's safe. And that makes it more efficient as well for me. I have there everything to hand and in one box. So that's, you know, bringing everything with you that you're going to need. It's planning ahead and it's thinking about what do I need today before I go and inspect my hives. Making sure I have all of that with me. It's all in one box, my smoker, my hay, my lighters, my hive tool, my apodeas, a nuke or two, whatever it is I'm going to need, extra frames of foundation. Bring it all with you. Make sure you have enough of equipment so that you're not really inefficiently having to drive away and come back to that apiary again. We often only get one or two, you know, we often only get one chance to do something in the apiary. You know, particularly as a weekend beekeeper, I don't have the luxury of saying I'll come back on Monday or I'll come back on Tuesday to do that. So I have one opportunity to get the job done in the apiary. And that's the way I look at it, is I need to have everything with me for whatever eventuality I'm going to have to, you know, do once I'm there. And I'm making the best use of my time while I am there. Efficiency at the hive. So again, new comb makes it easier to examine your bees. You know, with the older comb, there's less holes in it. So again, you know, once we're cutting out the old comb now and we'll have fresh foundation. If you have old black comb, there's a lot of holes going on in the black comb, and it's much more difficult to do your inspections. It's more difficult to see the eggs and see what's going on. And the queen, you know, she'll hide in and out of whatever crevices and combs are on those, or holes that are on those combs. And they do say that a full complement of comb equates to about 8% more brood inside in the hive as well. So that's why it's important to be switching out that fresh comb every year. I would recommend following a standard process, you know, so it's important to kind of have your process, know, you know, what you're going to approach, how you're going to do it, having a standard process, but also being very, very open-minded to changing that. It shouldn't be, this is my way and my way is right. You know, be open that other people have good ideas as well and being open to listen. You may disagree with some of them, but they may have some very good ideas that you can take away and try and use it. So being open to continuous improvement, right, and critically examining how I do things and my method of operation. Just because it has worked, you know, for years doesn't mean that it can't be improved or I can tweak it or do something interesting or do something different with it. The other point is there's very few occasions when you actually need to find your queen. So again, you know, and you see a lot of beginners want to see the queen every time they open the hive. You know, so there's very few occasions when we actually need to find her. So don't spend all day looking for queens. You know, totally inefficient. You don't need to see her. Don't need to find her. Once you know she's in there, if you see eggs, brood, young brood, etc., you know, you're going to make the assumption that your queen is fine and she's there. So not wasting time, really, during your hive inspection. Swarming, so again, with limited time on the swarming, I put in there, queens clipped and marked is a necessity for somebody like me. If I don't have my queens clipped and marked, you know, I'm going to lose swarms, basically, right? So, so to make myself efficient, to make sure I'm not losing swarms, I have all my queens clipped and marked. And marking them and clipping them early in the season, because there's less bees in the hive. So the best time to do that is early in the season. You'll find them easier and quicker. So the first, you know, two, three inspections, my queens, all my queens are clipped and marked at that stage. And then once I go through the season, the hives that are not building queen cells are on a 14-day inspection. I don't look at them outside of that if they don't need to be looked at. So, you know, sticking to that and only looking at what needs to be looked at and making the most efficient use of your time. If I do find queen cells, I have to take immediate action. Because as I say, I don't have the luxury of being back during the week, or even I might not get back the following Saturday because I might be on a different apiary or a different pattern. So the minute I find a queen cell, I'm taking action. I'm not breaking down queen cells and coming back. I'm taking action straight away. I'm either doing an artificial swarm or I'll take the queen out to a nuke. And that's how I manage my practice, because that's what works for me. You have to find out what works for you with the time limitations that you actually have. There are challenges, again, as a weekend beekeeper, there are challenges around some of the queen rearing, you know, will mean you to come back in 3 days, which I might not have the luxury to do. Apidias need to be in the garage for 3 days. I might be off traveling somewhere with work. So there are certainly challenges. Now, I'm very lucky. As I say, I come from a beekeeping family. I have my nephew, Gavin, my brother, my dad, whatever. You know, I can just give them the instructions and they'll leave the apidias out, or they'll do whatever needs to be done during the week, right? But, you know, it's to think about where you are challenged and how you can kind of get over those challenges. Also, when you're locating your apiaries, the time to get there is, you know, we spend a lot of time driving as beekeepers, driving here and there and to apiaries. So considering the location of your apiaries and what kind of a radius are they from your home base or from where most of your equipment is. And it's very, very important to think about that as well. And of course, as I say, I love doing observations from outside the hive, but you can be quite challenged with limited time to do that, you know. So that's why I'm trying to have time when I am there to at least enjoy it and to watch the bees from the outside. The sun, the weather is a big challenge. It doesn't always shine on Saturday and Sunday, you know. So, but there's very little we can do about that. There are occasions where we've had to go out with the umbrella up over the hive because they, you know, whether it be a queen rearing or whatever it is, we just need to do a particular operation and we do have to put the big umbrella up and continue on with it. So you know, you'll work around it, but obviously with limited time, there are challenges, right? So just to talk a little bit about technologies and beekeeping, it's probably a really interesting topic, I would think, for commercial beekeepers. You know, they say at the moment that we're in the fourth industrial revolution, and it's all centered around the internet and IoT. And there's beekeeping hasn't escaped from that, right? Beekeeping hasn't escaped from technology. And it's going to, I think it's going to get quite interesting, you know, over the next couple of years, particularly, as I say, from a commercial beekeeper's perspective, because a lot of these technologies can actually make beekeeping very, very efficient. And obviously, efficiency is equal to profitability and is equal to money. So, you know, the bigger beekeepers are probably going to become quite interested in what's out there. And there are new companies sprouting up all the time in terms of technologies for beekeeping. You know, as I spoke about earlier, you have your applications, your beekeeping apps for taking your notes. But there's some very sophisticated sensors on the market now. The picture here that's a hive. Actually, I took a picture of that in Copenhagen, and that's a good number of years ago in their apiary in Copenhagen, in the park in Copenhagen. And it had sensors in the hive. It was measuring the weight of the hive, the temperature, the inside temperature, the outside temperature, the temperature of the brood, the humidity. It had a whole range, you know, of metrics that the sensors were measuring, and it was connected up to a mobile phone, and 12 times a day it was sending information to the mobile phone, which was then basically putting that on an email and sending it out to all the members of that association from the apiary around the data, 12 times a day, just to think about that, right? But it was sending it out once, obviously, but the whole data was coming from, you know, data points throughout the day. So it was measuring all of these, you know, so that you could tell, like you can tell if the weight dropped 3 pounds in any given day, they definitely swarmed, right? And you can almost, you know, you can tell an awful lot of information on these sensors and what's happening inside in the hive. You know, and I'm working in Dell Technologies, and we actually had I was involved in putting a beehive on the roof of the building where we also had it connected up to the Internet of Things. And we were doing all the same kind of measures on this particular hive with sensors, and we had all of this data, and you could monitor how the hive is doing. So the point here really is that, you know, you can take efficiencies to any level. But it is getting very technology advanced for commercial beekeepers, you know, and I'm not really a fan in thinking that, you know, we'd be all sitting at home watching our beehives, you know, and how are they doing and their health, and the building queen cells, and we'd be sitting on the armchair as opposed to going out to our apiaries, right? But this is, you know, it's quite interesting the way it is going. There's a lot of technology there that is improving commercial beekeeping at a worldwide level. It's really improving it.
You mentioned you were going from commercial to national now for the reasons. I was just wondering, from your 20 hives, how do you go into the winter? Do you go brood, super, or double brood, or what? Oh, generally, I know you're going to say it depends.
Yeah.
But generally, what are you going into the winter?
Generally, at the moment, I'm actually on single brood. I'm not a fan of brood and a half or the brood and the super. So I'm either single brood or double brood. That's my preference. And I also think it can be good to put dummy boards, actually, if you do want to go double brood, you can put dummy boards in both doubles if they don't require the full box. And then that's it's really good in spring when you come back and you want to put in your fresh frames of foundation. I overwinter queens as well. So what I can do early in the spring is I take the double brood down, I can fill them with foundation, and I can put an overwintered queen into one half of it. So that's why I kind of work either doubles or singles, but I'm not a fan of the brood and a half. I find the half is neither here nor there, really, right? Yeah.
I also keep 20 colonies, and my biggest inefficiency is loading and unloading the car, which is a shared vehicle. And we have grandchildren and two car seats as well. So do you have any suggestions for that?
Buy a trailer. It can, no, seriously, because I know exactly, because I had a car, and if you're using it for family, etc., I actually had the Skoda where you can lift the seats out of it. So I ended up having to lift seats out every time I wanted to fill the car. But actually with a small trailer, you can get some really neat trailers that have hoods on them that you can lock, and you can even have equipment in there permanently. Stored. So I would say that's my advice, right? The trailer, yeah. Or a van or whatever works, right? But yeah, but you'd have more insurance then probably.
How do you do to overwinter queens?
How do I?
Overwinter queens,
overwinter
spare queens.
So I have pictures of them now, but I have these smaller, it's not an apodea, but it's a small polystyrene box with the smaller frames. It's about half the size of a normal brood box frame, right? And there's four or five of them. So I overwinter them in those small little polystyrene boxes. Now, they will be quite insulated. I've a roof that goes over the sides of it, so quite insulated. And I would build those up during the season. So obviously, when I'm doing my queen rearing program, I'd start building those up. You know, and once I've queens laying in them, maybe during the season, I might take them out and use them, but I'm filling them back up, be it with my queen cells from the queen breeding program or whatever. But they're just small polystyrene boxes. They're bigger than Apodeas, smaller than a nuke, and I'm overwintering them in those. Been quite successful over the last few years with them, actually.